Counselor Kimball, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Bonnie, can we have a roll call, please?
Counselor Kimball?
Present.
Counselor Lavoie?
Present.
Counselor McClure?
Here.
Counselor Neal?
Present.
Counselor Gilday?
Present.
Counselor Kelcourse?
Here.
And President Ferguson?
Present.
Counselor McMillian and Counselor Scorzoni have excused absences.
Welcome tonight to the meeting. I just wanted to let you know a couple things. First of all, tonight's proceedings are being televised by Amesbury Cable Television Channel 12 and recorded by the clerk. Thank you, Bonnie and Chris. We ask that you be really careful about approaching the desk during testimony because it makes noise and it's hard to hear. Copies of the agenda as well as the speaker request forms can be found at the back of the room. Anyone wishing to speak during public comment or on a particular agenda item is asked to fill out a speaker request form and give it to the clerk. The other thing I wanted to say is that tonight, the issue on the DPW is going to be continued until the next finance committee meeting. So if you have any comments that you want to speak on the DPW, need to talk at public comment, okay? Being as we have no minutes, we're going to go to mayoral appointments.
Can we read the first letter?
Yeah. The first appointment is 2012-025. Am I reading it?
No. Office of the Mayor, Certificate of Appointment, February 22nd, 2012. I hereby appoint Bruce Baranzai to the Tree Board for a term to expire June 30th, 2015, and I certify that said person has appeared before me and is qualified to perform the duties of said office, and I make this appointment solely in the interest of the town of Amesbury. Said person is not a member of any other Amesbury board, committee, commission, nor an employee of the town of Amesbury. Bruce, would you like to come up and say a few words, please?
Just state your name and your address, and you can tell us a little bit about why you want to do this.
My name is Bruce Barassa. I'm residence at 11 Willowdale Court in Amesbury. I've been a resident in town for 7 years, and I'm also a Massachusetts certified horticulturist and an arborist. And I'm also a self-employed landscape contractor for 20 years. So I would like to help out the town. Very interested in trees and overseeing and maintaining them.
Does anybody have any questions? Counselor Kimball?
Thank you. Thank you for stepping up. We really appreciate it. I just wanted to get any of your perspective on, I work for a utility, and a lot of the trees in town, you can argue that they were the cause of a lot of the outages that came up over the last, 6 months or so. Do you have any philosophy on tree trimming, any experience in dealing with utilities maybe, and pushing them to act on some of the issues that we might have with trees to, avoid those situations that we had with the power issues last year?
Well, a lot of the older trees, the maples and the oaks, do need to continue to be pruned, thinned out on a maintenance program, but things have changed a lot in the last few years. A lot of the newer street tree plantings, they're using smaller compact varieties. The crowns stay tighter, Chanticleer pears, tree lilacs, and that's going to help out a lot later on down the road. Mm-hmm. But for now, definitely a proactive pruning approach.
Okay, thank you. Appreciate that.
Sure.
Thank you. If we have we had a little trouble with the microphones tomorrow. Sorry. If we have no further comments, entertain a motion. Counselor Kimball?
I'd like to move to accept the mayoral appointment 2012-025, Bruce Barassa, to the Tree Board, term to expire 6/30/2015.
Can I have a second? Councilor Kim, Councilor McClure seconds. All in favor? Any opposed? That's unanimous. Thank you so much, Mr.
Thank
Barassa.
Thanks for stepping up.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
The next appointment is 2012-026. Do you want to read that?
Sure. Office of the Mayor, Certificate of Appointment, February 22nd, 2012. I hereby appoint Ken Espelag, if I'm not pronouncing your name correctly, forgive me please, to the Lakes and Waterways Commission for an unexpired term to expire 6/30/2013. I certify that said person has appeared before me and is qualified to perform the duties of said office, and I make this appointment solely for the interests in the town of Amesbury. Said person is not a member of any other Amesbury board, committee, commission, nor an employee of the town of Amesbury. Ken, would you like to come up and say a few words, please? Could you pronounce your last name?
Yeah, my name is Ken Aspisley.
I didn't do too bad then.
Yeah, you're very close.
Yeah.
I live at 195 Market Street. I've been in Amesbury for about 2 years, and I've been involved with some private lake organization in town. I'm an active user of Lake Gardner and the Powell River. And when I found out about the vacancy on the Lakes and Waterways, I jumped at the opportunity to help out in town.
Do I have any questions from councilors? No. If not, I would love to entertain a motion. Councilor Lavoie?
I move that this appointment 2012-026 to the Lakes and Waterways Commission, unexpired term to expire June 30, 2013, be approved.
A second? Councilor Neal seconds. All in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? That's unanimous, Bonnie. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Good luck. I have another appointment. 2012-027, Abigail Muse. Is that Abigail here? Good. Go ahead.
Okay. Office of the Mayor, Certificate of Appointment, February 27th, 2012. I hereby appoint Abigail Muse to the Historical Commission for a term to expire 6/30/2015, and I certify that said person has appeared before me and is qualified to perform the duties of said office, and I make this appointment solely in the interest of the town of Amesbury. Said person is not a member of any other Amesbury board, committee, or commission, nor an employee of the town of Amesbury. Abigail, would you please come up and say a few words, please? Thank you.
My name is Abigail Muse. I'm a native of Amesbury, so I've lived here all my life, went through the school system. Just moved back after grad school. I got a degree in historic preservation to follow up my preservation history degrees from undergrad. So I'm just looking forward to helping the town with what I've learned.
Any comments from councilors?
Nice resume.
Yeah.
Excellent resume, and I'm glad that you're interested in giving back. Warms our hearts to see people return to the community where they were born. Thank
Great.
You.
Thank you.
I just want to say that I know Abigail from the Amesbury Treasures, and she has worked tirelessly on so many projects. So when you say coming back, she's continuing her amazing work, and we are so lucky to have you. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. We're going to vote on your appointment now. I would like to entertain a motion.
I move that we accept 2012-27 appointment of Abigail Muse to the Historical Commission, term to expire 6/30/15.
I have a second. From Councilor Neal. Councilor Neal. Okay, second. All in favor, please raise. Any opposed? That's unanimous. Thank you so much, Abigail.
Thank you. Thanks for stepping up. Appreciate it.
Okay, we do actually have a late file, and the late file involves two appointments. And so I would entertain a motion to accept this late file out of to accept this late file. Councilor Neal?
I move to accept late files 2012-037 and 2012-038.
Do I have a second for that?
Yes.
Councilor Gilday seconds. We have an appointment. All in favor? Any opposed? It's unanimous. The first appointment is Cynthia Costello to the Council on Aging, term to expire 6/30/15. Cynthia, are you here? Not here.
I was informed that she was not available, and this is a reappointment.
Oh, okay.
So, in accordance with our practices, if it's in order, I would move acceptance of her appointment.
Okay. Okay. So, could I have a motion for?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Councilor Neal seconds. All in favor? All opposed? That's unanimous. So, we're appointing Cynthia Costello to the Council on Aging, a reappointment to expire 6/30/15. The next appointment is 2012-038. Do you want to read that for me?
Sure. Office of the Mayor, Certificate of Appointment, March 9th, 2012. I hereby appoint Benjamin Osgood Jr. to the Zoning Board of Appeals for a term to expire June 30th, 2017. And I certify that said person has appeared before me and is qualified to perform the duties of said office, and I make this appointment solely in the interest of the town of Amesbury. Said person is not a member of any other Amesbury board, committee, commission, nor an employee of the town of Amesbury. Mr. Osgood, are you here, please?
Oh. Good evening. My name is Ben Osgood, Jr. I live at 16 Hillside Ave, and I've been a resident of Amesbury for 2.5 years. I'm a registered professional engineer, and part of my employment, I do permitting in front of zoning, planning, conservation commissions. I've always wanted to be on a board, but I did a lot of work in the towns I lived in, and I don't do any work here, so I'd like to offer my services and help out. Amesbury's a great town, and I want to see it grow, but still keep its character, which I think the zoning board has a big part in. So. Happy to offer my services.
Thank you. Any comments?
I know Mr. Osgood. He enjoys a fine reputation. I practice in the Andover area, and I know he's appeared before boards in the Andover, North Andover. I've known him for a number of years, and I am very much in favor of this.
Thank you. Any other comments from councilors?
Oh, the board would do well to have a civil engineer on it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. Nice. If there's no further comments, I would like to entertain a motion from Councilor Lavoie.
Madam President, on 2012-038, the appointment of Ben Osgood Jr. to the Zoning Board of Appeals for a term to expire June 30, 2017, I move approval of this appointment.
And a second?
Second.
Councilor Gilday seconds. All in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? So that's unanimous. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
You got a nice little name, Osgood.
Welcome.
Right.
And so
thank
you. You moved home. The next we have is licenses and permits. A national 2012-028 National Grid poll hearing, Middle Road. Is there someone from National Grid to chat about this?
Will we read the petition first, Ann?
Okay,
Council President, please. I'm sorry.
Just 1 minute. He's going to read for me.
Okay. Petition for pole and wire locations to the Municipal Council of Amesbury, Massachusetts. National Grid requests permission to locate poles, wires, and fixtures, including the necessary sustaining and protecting fixtures along the access the following public way. Middle Road installment of sole-owned utility poles to accommodate the 2396 overhead line tap to Merrimack project. Location approximately is as shown on the plan attached. Excuse me. Wherefore, it prays that after due notice and hearing is provided by law, it be granted a location for and permission to erect and maintain poles, wires, together with such substantiating and protecting fixtures as it may seem necessary. Said poles to be erected substantially in accordance with the plan filed here with Mark Middle Road, Amesbury, Massachusetts. 11833219, February 15, 2002. Also, for permission to lay and maintain underground lateral cables and wires in above or intersecting public ways for the purpose of making connections with such poles and buildings as each of said petitioners may desire for distribution purposes. Your petition agrees to reserve space for one cross arm and suitable point on each of said poles for fire, police, telephone, telegraph, signal wires belonging to the municipality and used by it exclusively for municipal purposes. National Grid. Would the representative from National Grid want to just say a few words and explain the diagram a little bit?
My name is Jason Small. I'm a project manager with National Grid. The address is 1101 Turnpike Street, North Andover, Mass. The reason for this project is we are required to provide service to Merrimack and the municipal, and this is part of the project to give them a second service. The location is on Middle Road near the Merrimack town line, so there's an existing transmission and sub-transmission right away that crosses Middle Road going to the new substation that was built a couple years ago. And the new poles are starting at that right-of-way and going towards Merrimack, not towards Amesbury. The five poles are required for the amount of equipment that we have to install in order to provide them service. That's pretty much the project.
Okay. Do we have any comments from council? Councilor Lavoie?
Are you acquainted with, or have you seen the March 7 letter from our town engineer?
No, I have not.
Would you mind? For the audience and the viewing public, the letter from the town engineer doesn't speak to the merits, but in terms of the application, the diagram is simply that, a diagram, and the town engineer is recommending a more precise plan location plan, which maybe after you scan that, if you want to speak to that, I'm sure we'll all be interested. Right?
We're just giving him a minute to look at this letter from the engineer. Is there any other abutters here? If you could raise your hand, those two. Anyone else?
Okay, the basic nature of the letter speaks to it was hard to ascertain the location of the new pole locations based on the submitted drawing. The pole locations are going to be within a few feet of the edge of the road, approximately probably 5 feet off the edge of the road. There are...
well within the town right-of-way?
Yes, I would believe so, yes.
We trust but verify here, so...
Yes. the intention is it would be within the right-of-way. The side of the road we're on, our right-of-way does abut the entire length that we are setting the poles. It notes a stream. We did do an environmental review internally. Our environmental engineer signed off stating that we were not within the buffer zone. That is something we could add to the drawing as requested by the engineer. We can work to this and enhance the drawing a little bit.
Madam President, I'm not intimately acquainted with the project, but as we all know, Merrimack has municipal lighting. So in other words, the town of Merrimack itself provides their own electricity. If I understand the gentleman correctly, this is a backup connection, and I think Councilor Neal can help us along too. But my point to the council would be this, that I think there's a time sensitivity so that, if at all possible, we should, find a way to vote this in the affirmative tonight. But I believe it would be appropriate to condition it upon satisfaction of our town engineer with an ultimate pole diagram satisfactory to him before installation commences. And when it's time for a motion, I'll be glad to make that motion. But I'd like to hear Councilor Neal, too.
Are we voting on this?
Well, let me just state first off, Mr. Manor, this isn't the first time. It's an unfortunate thing. I know somebody cranks these things out. But there's a great reluctance to show the edge of the road.
Okay.
Because I think you probably use property lines or some such thing on your internal drawings. But, you know, when someone from the Department of Public Works has to go out and look at it, or in our case, the councilors who approve it, it's difficult to look at a picture like that rather than, you know, where's the edge of the road, and it's going to be here. Now, we were fortunate enough to be able to see the stakes, which again were difficult to see, but we did see the stakes that you had set out for the poles. And, you know, I guess in my opinion, they appear to be benign enough. In other words, they're off the road enough. You know, they're not too far off the road. And the only thing that I saw was that you might have a couple of trees in your way that appeared to be, you know, manageable to trim back or remove if that had to happen. But, you know, they weren't substantive trees. And so it looked like a benign project. And we do understand that you are trying to give a feed to Merrimack. That was part of the original agreement when you built the substation out there to provide them a feeder. Is that correct?
Yes. Merrimack had gotten involved with the DPU when we were trying to get a new 115 transmission line for the new sub. And part of the order of conditions from the settlement with the Department of Public Utilities was that we had to provide them the second 23 kV service, actually at this location. It was actually specified in the order of conditions.
Yesterday afternoon, Councilor Neal and myself met with this gentleman and another gentleman's name I can't remember off the top of my head. And we saw where the existing pole 158 is right now, and we saw the staking of the other poles. I was pretty well pleased that they were offset from the edge of the road, not to interfere with plowing or cars or anything like that. And I believe that those poles are on the overhead right-of-way of National Grid property, and there is some tree trimming that needs to be done there. Whose trees those are, I cannot tell at this time, but before any tree trimming would take effect, because they would affect the lines going up and across the street into Merrimack, that should be addressed by, you know, if anybody does have ownership of that land. But I believe even some of the trees are in the right-of-way utility easement, you know, setback, and also in the yard right of way. But I would like to see some kind of mutual agreement, correspondence with the town engineer of Amesbury before you really start, you know, setting the poles and going forward. That'd be one of the stipulations.
Yes, we could definitely provide that. We will work with him.
Right, because basically it's going to be a diverse feed for Merrimack in case the existing feed from the substation goes down. They have a backup, what they call, you know, diversity
of supply. Yeah.
Is there any further comment from the councilors? I do have two abutters, and because this is a hearing, we'd like to hear from you at this time. So, Mr. Snow, if you'd like to just step down for a second, I'm going to have these two gentlemen give a little chat.
Okay.
Mark Pender.
Do you want the letter back? Why don't you keep that?
Yeah. If you just step up and say your name and where you live.
Yes, my name's Mark Pender. I live at 90 Middle Road. I abut all the property that abuts National Grid. First thing on that map they have for the abutters list is on the other side of the highway, so I don't even know where they are over there. So, and second of all, they're cutting trees on my property. They are already harvested large timber that was on my property, and they're in a lawsuit to stop. They are told not to proceed with any more tree cutting till they settle that issue up front. The agreement when they put the substation, it was all underground utilities. that left that substation. They have a trunk that turns up that road and heads for that. The only reason they're avoiding going underground is there is a culvert that's in their way, which is probably a $1 million project to replace that culvert. So they're trying to save a buck and not go up that road. So I don't see why they can't stay on the same agreement they did in the first place.
Okay, is any other comments from the other councilors on this issue?
Well, let me just, it's your contention that the trees that they must trim are
yes,
on your
are
property,
on my property
and not in their right of way?
Right.
And they are not in the right of way, they are on your property, is that
yes.
correct?
There's a large oak that leans right over the road that will block the utility of the put in there.
All right, let me make a request that when you resubmit the plan, I would like to see your right-of-way overlaid on this map so that I can get a sense, and I'm sure my fellow councilors want to get a sense of whether that's his trees or they clearly are in your right-of-way. Thank you.
Thank you.
Brian Patterson.
Good evening. I'm not a direct abutter, but I am an abutter to Pender Farm, and I have been watching the project through National Grid since the onset of the power plant. And it's a little disconcerting that the last time they got a permit to bring the main power lines to the plant, they cut old growth trees that were not on their right of way with Mr. Pender. And from talking to Mr. Pender, they have not attempted to make a settlement with him over any of these trees that they cut. And they cut these trees mainly to maneuver their equipment into the main power line to put up these steel structures, these steel power poles, I guess. None of that was laid out in their previous plans. So I'm glad to see you're asking a lot of questions about this one, but previous history shows that they do what they have to get the job done, regardless of the abutter. I would like to see the permit not issued, so that and suggest that they make an attempt to settle the grievance with Mr. Pender. That's my opinion.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sure.
Mr. Pender, would you mind just hopping up again? And I just wanted to ask you a quick question. According to the last right-of-way where they cut trees that you alleged, I mean, I don't know because I haven't seen them, but I do believe that they're old growth, large trees. How many trees were affected in that situation?
Two. The bases were this big around on those trees.
Okay. And they didn't give you any warning that they were going to do that or ask any permission?
Nope. I was informed they were trimming trees. I had no problem with them trimming. That was the agreement. They trimmed. They did not cut. I came home, their neighbors were in there like ants, and the lumber was gone before I could do a thing about that.
Okay. And
one of their foremen approached me, said they were going to reimburse me for the timber they removed or replace the timber. Well, after the deal was, their trees are down, they had no more problem, they don't contact me anymore. I have an attorney that's contacted them. They still, to date, have not contacted that attorney.
And when did this happen? What
It was the fall of last year.
Fall of 2011?
Yes.
Okay. And specifically on this issue with this National Grid pole, you're opposed to the project itself or just
No, I don't mind them doing their work. I know they have to do their work. I think they ought to go underground there. It's a better system underground because you can't hurt an underground utility. The tree can't fall, the snow can't knock it down. Nothing can affect that underground utility. They have a trunk that came out of their sump station and turned that way, because I witnessed the trunk going in the ground. So I don't see why they don't run it up underground. I know it's more expensive for them.
Okay. All right, thank you very much.
Does
anyone
welcome.
Else have more questions? Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So,
if you're going to ask for more testimony, if there's anybody.
Yeah, yeah. Is there anyone else in the audience that would like to speak on this issue? Okay. If there's no more testimony and any more counselor comment, I would like to entertain a motion on this issue. 2012-028.
I have plenty to say about it, but to get it before us, I'd like to see if we get a motion and a second, and I'll be glad to make the motion. I don't know where the second will come from, but I would move for conditionally granting this petition, 2012-028, subject to three conditions, the first being that the town of the city known as the town of Amesbury be provided with a scaled plan indicating a right-of-way line, including current property owners being identified on the plan adjacent to the roadway. Secondly, and that the small stream that runs down the adjacent property be located on said plan. The second condition would be that there be compliance with all other applicable rules, regulations, federal, state, and local, including consultation with the Amesbury Conservation Commission, which may or may not have already occurred. And thirdly, that prior to installation of any poles, DigSafe, the Town of Amesbury Department of Public Works, and the Town Water and Sewer Departments be informed of the proposed activities so that they can govern themselves accordingly, either to witness or be satisfied.
Do I have a second for that?
I'd like to, you know, add something if we could about who actually has the ownership of those trees in that right of way.
I just need a second and then we can discuss it some more.
You can amend the motion, Adam.
You can amend the motion.
Is there a second?
Second by Councilor Kalkhorst. Discussion?
As framer of the motion, I appreciate being able to speak to it. So my understanding is this, that it's important that this project be approved tonight, okay? It doesn't mean that we can't condition it, and I think I've framed three solid conditions based upon our town engineer's recommendations. On the issue of the trees, it's an important civil dispute between Mr. Pender and anybody else affected and National Grid. You know, Massachusetts law provides remedies for people who cut other people's trees. It's pretty severe. It's three times damages. But we are not the Massachusetts Superior Court, and it's not our role to intervene in private litigation disputes, even if it's the public utility. Our job is within the public right-of-way, whether or not to allow the petition of a public utility governed by the Department of Public Utility, Massachusetts, who can sanction and fine and, you know, do all kinds of nasty things to utilities that don't obey the PUC regulations and other applicable law. I feel sympathetic to Mr. Pender's plight, but, you know, it's not our job to referee that dispute, nor should it be allowed to basically use us. Mr. Pender should not be allowed to use us to leverage against National Grid. That's a civil dispute for the courts. There's plenty of ways to resolve it. I'm sure if the gentleman here from National Grid reports back that we are all disturbed and exercised by the conduct of National Grid, and if any of us had personal witnessing, would be glad to testify in a court of law, but I don't think any of us witnessed that. So I don't mean to get so worked up, but, you know, I think it's important for us to consider our role, and number two, to allow our adjoining community to have the safety and security of this second installation. Our city concerns by our town engineer have, you know, if the conditions that I've laid out do it, he'll be satisfied. And I think we should conditionally approve it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is any further comments?
I'd just like to indicate that I think conditioning these this request, National Grid's request, on these three items that Councilor Lavoie has outlined, you know, in a way does protect Mr. Pender's rights as a property owner too. So because they're going to have to clearly delineate the boundary lines, the property lines. So I think it is somewhat helpful, and I think it's a good motion.
Any further comments?
Mr. Pender stated that, you know, he didn't mind the poles, you know, really being set there. He would, you know, his first preference would be to go underground, but I know that could, you know, cost 10, 15 times as much money. And as Councilor Lavoie said, we really can't comment on the litigations that he has right now. So that's all I have to say at this point.
I just
sure.
Can I ask you one question from the podium? Mr. Small, do you know, and if not, can you get us the answer subsequent to this hearing? Is there anything in your approval from Department of Public Utilities that requires you to put this line underground?
No, the way it was spelled out in the order of conditions, we did specify overhead at the time. The only thing I'd like to point out about the whole underground is we're tapping the right-of-way. This isn't back up at the substation where we did come underground, so it's already an overhead right-of-way. Approximately, I had this up, we'll say 200 feet down the road is the Merrimack pole, which is overhead. So even if we went underground from there, it would basically be 200 feet of under, it'd be a pole that we'd still be requesting permission for to be able to go underground. And then we'd be underground for 200 feet, and then we'd pop back up on Merrimack. Merrimack does have to pay for the second service, so it would be an increased cost to the to Merrimack Municipal. So that's where that stood, and that's why we went overhead. So everything was overhead around it. So.
And to put it in perspective, this line of poles from 157-50, the new pole, to the Merrimack Town line, again, this isn't scaled, but it's approximately 200 feet.
Yes, I
25, 50, 30.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's about right. So again, right. I would just ask the council to keep in perspective that this is a line of poles 200 feet in length on 93 mile streets that, you know, street of miles that Amesbury has. So.
And let me just suggest that the reason there are poles, as I recall, you have switching.
Yes, we have to install primary metering to meter the service. We have to install a switch that we can open to delineate the line of demarcation between what we own and what they own in case they need to take any kind of service.
So you needed at least three poles to accommodate your gear, right?
Yes, so to go underground, it would be challenging.
Right.
I did leave that out, you're correct. Yeah.
Any other comments? I would personally like to say that I love trees. I feel sad that you would have cut an old, large tree like that without having had a conversation with the landowners. And I understand that there's a lot involved to it. And I would, if this measure passes, I would like that you would include, prior to any cutting, at least Mr. Pender, in this issue so that, you know, there won't, trimming is a lot different than completely cut ground cutting a tree. And I would have been as horrified to come home and see that as he would be. And I would plead personally to that this would be resolved and done, you know.
I was not involved in the previous project that did that, but I will take all this back. I will go back. I will talk to our legal counsel at our company and try to figure out what exactly is going on with this.
Thank
That's
you.
The best I can do. As far as any trimming on this project, I am more than willing to meet you out there with our tree, with our arborist that works in North Andover. We can meet out there with you anytime. He can lay out what he wants his tree crews to do to make room for our lines, and we can really work with you on this particular project. I apologize for anything that may have happened in the past. I had nothing to do with it. I don't know even where that stands. I know nothing about it.
Okay.
So I can't really speak to it. I'm a homeowner myself, so I can sympathize. I can't speak on anything that has to do with the past. But I can't, the best I can do is go back and try to find out if where it stands.
Okay, I appreciate it. Is there any more comment? Councilor Neal, one more comment?
Yeah. I do.
Just as a, you know, a former utility guy that had to submit drawings for permits, I want you to take back, because this is, I don't know how many that I've seen that do not delineate the pavement edge. It's just wrong. You're asking people that don't really know your system to go out to a site and make an assessment without giving them some landmarks. It's going to be very difficult for them to say yay or nay. So the more edge of pavement, this pole number, this house number, you know, this stream, those are very important things. And so if the person had that picture in front of them, it would make it a lot easier.
I agree.
Yeah.
I
appreciate you have an in-house organ that you have to get through, but really, you know, from my perspective as a counselor, I don't want to see this again because it raises way too many questions. And we have to work twice as hard ourselves to be familiar with what you want to do. Because eventually, we're the guys that have to go yay or nay. And so if we don't have a clear picture, difficult.
I will definitely bring that
message
back
to you. Thank you
very much.
Any further comment, briefly?
Would the address be Jim MacArthur?
Yes.
Yes, I've met with Jim out in the field, and he's a very reasonable and knowledgeable gentleman. I'm glad he's going to be coming out looking at the trees. Thank you.
So I think we're ready to move this question. And I would just like to say to Mr. Pender that I would really appreciate it if you would call me if you have any further problems. And I will be glad to meet you on the land and work on with this issue. Okay, with the cutting in the trees especially. Okay. So if there's no further comment, I would like to have a vote on the motion with the
no, I think
conditional
the motion.
Granting?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. All in favor? Any opposed? No. The motion passed conditionally. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, Jason.
The next thing we have is a general business license for In Country Accounting Systems. It's 2012-029 In Country Accounting Services. General business license for bookkeeping at 7 Whitewood Circle, Amesbury, Mass. Is Linda here?
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. My name's Linda Incontri, and I live at 7 Whitewood Circle, Amesbury, Mass. And I've resided there for 10 years, and I'm here to obtain a business license.
Good. Have you ever done this type of bookkeeping? And are you planning to do it out of your home or?
A couple of the people that I'm already doing, I go to their offices, but from time to time I have to bring work home and work in the home.
Okay. Is there any other questions for counselors?
Will you be having clients at your home?
At this point, no.
Right, because this is a residential zone.
This, yes.
So.
I understand that.
Okay. Any other questions? So I'd like to entertain a motion. Counselor Kelcourse.
I move that we accept 2012-29 general business license In Country Accounting Services, 7 Whitewood Circle.
Second for Counselor McClure seconds. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed? That's unanimous. Thank you so much.
Thank
Good
you.
Luck.
Thank
Good
you.
Luck. Okay, moving right along. the next thing we have is correspondence. I have a 2012-030 declare vacancy on the Amesbury Housing Authority. I'll read a letter from the clerk, Bonnie Jo Kitchen. Dear President Ferguson, I have received the resignation of Albert Landry, a member of the Amesbury Housing Authority, which leaves a vacancy with a term to expire in 2013. If a vacancy occurs in the membership of the school committee, planning board, board of library trustees, or housing authority, whether by failure to elect or otherwise, the president of the municipal council shall, within 30 days following the date of such vacancy is declared to exist, call a joint meeting of the municipal council and the board, commission, or committee on which such vacancy shall exist for the purpose of filling said vacancy. At any such joint meeting, a majority of those present and voting shall choose the defeated candidate for the seat in which the vacancy is declared to exist at the last regular town election immediately preceding the date of vacancy is declared to exist. Mr. Landry's resignation was received February 10th, 2012. There were no defeated candidates that received 25% of the vote in the 2009 election for the office of the Amesbury Housing Authority. Once the municipal council declares the vacancy, it will be posted online and in the newspaper. You will need to schedule a joint meeting with the Amesbury Housing Authority within 30 days of the declared vacancy. So I would like first to take a motion to declare, to accept Mr. Landry's resignation and to declare a vacancy on the Amesbury Housing Authority.
So moved.
So moved, moved by Councilor McClure.
Second.
Second by Councilor Gilday. Any discussion?
I'd like to acknowledge Mr. Landry on behalf of myself and the council and the town for his service. I really appreciate the work he's done.
I have worked with Mr. Landry on many different projects, mm-hmm. and he was a tireless advocate for the people at the Housing Authority and Heritage Towers, and he met with me many times on weekends, and I really appreciate all the time and energy that he spent. So, any other? So, I'd like to vote this. All in favor, please raise their hand. Any opposed? That's unanimous. The other thing of comment is that Bonnie Jo did mention to me that the Housing Authority will not have a quorum at our next municipal council meeting. So we will have to bump this meeting to April, is that correct? Or May?
May 8th.
So because they know that the people that are on the housing will not be there, we're gonna move this to May 8th. Okay, you'll take note of that and it'll be advertised.
Yes.
Thank you.
Madam President?
Yes.
Is anyone knowledgeable about whether that the other remaining Housing Authority board members, are they crimped in their, is that going to crimp their style waiting so long, or are they?
No, they actually are the ones that will not have a quorum
on that day
on the Housing Authority,
and their business will permit them to go till May.
Right.
Okay, it's up to them, because we can accommodate them by having another date for us.
No, he's going to be out of the state for a while, so.
Okay.
That was their request.
The other bit of communication and business for the council is that we have a list of committees on the city council, and I would like to pass them out, and I'd like us to approve or deny that. So, actually, if you wouldn't mind reading this while I pass them out. These
sure.
are the council committees.
Okay, these are the Amesbury City Council committees, January 2012.
I thought you passed on reading.
Finance, all councilors. Ordinance, Bob Lavoie, Councilor Bob Lavoie, Councilor Derek Kimball, Councilor Jim Kelcourse, two citizen members, Len Johnson, Steve Dunford. Rules and procedures, Councilor Bob Lavoie, Councilor Alan Neal, Councilor Donna McClure. Emergency Task Force, Councilor Derek Kimball, Councilor Christian Scorzoni, Councilor Joe McMillian. School Space Need, Councilor Alan Neal. Traffic and Transportation Committee, Councilor Jim Kelcourse. Chamber of Commerce Liaison, Derek Kimball, Bob Gilday. Audit and Oversight, Councilor Bob Gilday, Councilor Derek Kimball. Master Plan Implementation, Councilor Donna McClure. Woodson Farm Liaison, Councilor Bob Lavoie.
Red. I'd like to make a...
Ready for a motion?
Yeah, I am.
Madam President, I would move that the council approve your committee approvals retroactive to January 2012 and ratify and confirm any action that those committees may have taken in the interim.
Do I have a second for that?
Second.
Councilor Kimball seconds that. Could we have a vote? All in favor, please raise their hand. All opposed? That's unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you.
Under, Madam President, under correspondence from such committees, I can speak on behalf of the Energy Task Force that we will be looking for citizen volunteers. I believe there was a task force that was convened in the previous council, maybe two councils ago. I plan to do some outreach to those folks to see if they're interested in serving again, but just putting that out there now, that we will be reconvening hopefully late March or early April. So.
Thank you very much. So if anybody's interested, you can go to the clerk and in the mayor and put a request in. Is there any other communications from the council? I would like to open public comment. And just a reminder that public comment is if you'll come to the podium, if you use your microphone, and if you'll state your name and your address, and I will and limit your comments to 3 minutes, please. The first person I have is Claude Gonthier.
Good evening, my name's Claude Gonthier, 112 Kimball Road. Tonight I'm gonna present some information as a result of things I've heard communicating and rationalizing an argument for the building of and renovating of the safety department, and most recently with the DPW facility relocation. And the thing that was said or written was that we have to do this now because past former governments didn't do it. It's our responsibility. There was no infrastructure investment into the town of Amesbury. And I understand this now when I'm thinking about it. These people weren't born when these things were done, or they didn't reside in the town. In any event, set the record straight. In 1968, we built the high school. In 1967, we built the middle school, the first addition, to the then 12-year-old junior high, which was built in the mid-50s. In 1968, we built a new elementary school. In 1975, we built a new Cashman School. In 1974, we renovated the Horace Mann School. In the early 60s, I can't give you the exact date, it's just going on memory, we built the first addition to the hospital. In the early 70s, we built a 1 million gallon water storage facility up on Poe Hill. In the mid 70s, we bought a ladder truck, which might seem like was like $150,000, but that was a lot of money back in the early 70s. We built the second addition to the hospital around 1980. That was a major undertaking. We bought the Woodson Farm around 88-89, I think, and I think that was like $4.5 million. In 1985, we built the water treatment plant. I was selectman then. Our highest water rate usage at that time was like 1.5 million gallons. We built a facility that we had two bays that processed water. They were duplicate bays. They could run in series or individually. The plant was made to operate at just one of these lines running. That was a two and a quarter million gallon capacity. It had the capacity to do 4.5 million gallons. If we needed to. So we planned for the future. And it had a shed roof with a metal covering. So we wouldn't have these flat roofs that you constantly had to repair and did a lot of damage. 1975, the waste treatment plant was built, or started to be built. Along with that, we did massive reconstruction of sewer lines, interceptors, mains, everything. And In addition to all that, in the early part of the 1970s, the mid-70s, we started an annual program where we put a dollar on the tax rate in an article for the pavement, for the repairs of streets and sidewalks. And in the first year we did it, that represented $65,000, a dollar on the tax rate. The last memory I had that we were doing it, it was up to like $125,000. We did that every year. We put it in an article for one reason. We didn't, if the money couldn't be used that fiscal year, it would be in that article and it had to be for a specific purpose, rebuilding or repaving of roads. So, and that was an ongoing process. That was in addition to Chapter 90 funds. So, whenever you hear anybody say past generations or past form of governments didn't take care of the needs of the town of Amesbury, didn't plan for the future, then just gently remind them that you weren't around then, but they did. And so we don't have any shame, we don't feel guilty, and we don't need this as a club to put us into something we don't think is necessary or is too expensive. We used to think things through, and I think we should go back to that. If you need something, fine. Then you find out how to keep the cost down. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Gonthier. Jane Snow?
Evening. Jane Snow, 44 Fern Ave. Last year, I had heard through a report that they were able to come to the Amesbury Leaf Dump and dump. So I contacted then President Bob Lavoie, Council President Bob Lavoie, and he assured me that it had not come in front of the council and so forth and so on. Yet fees were collected. And so I thought, well, it's a one-time thing. Amesbury's Newport's in trouble. Amesbury's helping. So what I would like to know from the council is, since it's on the sheet again this year that we are allowing out-of-town people to get stickers, when that came in front of the council and the rationale for the council of passing it when it's against state law to use a cemetery for anything other than a cemetery. And we've all known this and we've all said, you know, keep your fingers and toes crossed, we'll move it out of there when the DPW gets a new home. But I think this is a real little kind of zing, so I'd like to know in writing from the council president when this came in front of the council, how it was discussed, and the rationale behind it, and how the fees were set.
Thanks. Thank you. Allison Lindstrom.
I'm back. Allison Lindstrom, Wells Ave. I'm here, I would like to talk about the DPW and the move to, the comparison of the DPW being moved to the, what do you call it? Waste management site, the SCA disposal site, as opposed to the truck stop. What I did was I went through and I will give this to you, but I need it for myself right now. I compared them, and we own the truck stop. We don't own the disposal site, so that's a $650,000 excess, you know, charge for Amesbury, extra charge. We currently have no tax revenue on the truck stop. However, we do have tax revenue on the SCA disposal site, and that will be lost revenue permanently. There is water and sewer available at the truck stop. There is none available to even the site. Aside from having to bring it all the way down the site, you need to put the infrastructure in. So that's another extra cost for Amesbury. There's no electric or there's electric and phone available readily at the truck stop. Oh, and the water and sewer at the truck stop, the hookup is big enough to accommodate a truck stop, a bar, a diner, and a little motel. So it would be substantial what's available. The electric and phone is not available at the site up at the SCA disposal site. The site at the truck stop was tested. It was clean. It was cleaned up. We don't know, which was brought out at the Finance Committee, whether or not the SCA disposal site is dirty or not. So there's a liability for the town right there, which is an extra cost. the liability at the truck stop would be minimal. The site work is basically done at the truck stop. It's not done at all and needs significant amount of work at the SCA disposal site, so there's more money. The truck stop is partially paved. There is no paving at the SCA disposal site. There's another extra cost for Amesbury. The building costs, if we go with General Steel or Morton or something like that, I sent you guys a packet from General Steel 4 years ago, and I was given a price of soup to nuts, simple grading of the land, all the way to paint, plumbing, and electricity. I was given a price of $50 to $75 a square foot. So I upped that up to possibly $150 a square foot through General Steel and compared that to the PAR estimate cost of $370 or so, which saves Amesbury $4.5 to $6 million if we go with General Steel on the truck stop. The truck stop will be able to fit a leaf dump. We already dump snow there. Currently, the leaf dump is attached to the cemetery, which is illegal. We all know that. But at the same time, it's right next to a house. So it's not a really monumentally disturbing thing. Aside from that, the DPW works 7 to 3 or 8 to 4. That's during business hours. People are not home. They don't work at night except in the winter with the snow removal. I can hear that. I can hear it. I live over on Wells Ave, which is over by Cumberland Farms on 110. I can hear it from, I can hear the snow removal from downtown all the way to the truck stop. I hear it. So it's not going to disturb anybody if it's all the way out at the SCA disposal site. I counted the homes. There's five abutters to the truck stop. There's 14 homes that these trucks will go by every day as they're going to work, back and forth from work. There's 13 businesses. Maybe there's more or less because some of those big buildings may be condo units. Out to the SCA disposal site has an S-curve. It's barely two cars wide. It's endangering the neighborhood. Whereas the truck stop, it's a one-shot deal right off of 110. We're not relocating all the employees to either site. We've already got abandoned buildings. We own property we're not using. I don't understand why we would want to buy more property. And it's accessible to everybody at the truck stop. And if you develop the site at the truck stop, the site becomes attractive. Nobody's been interested in over 10 years while it's been empty. So if a developer sees this, he'll buy it. He won't care that the DPW is there, and we'll be able to move the building because he'll purchase it.
Thank you. You talk really quick and got a lot of information. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Joseph from Orchard Street.
Mr. Graney.
Yeah. I couldn't read your writing. I'm sorry.
My main reason for coming tonight is this. I spoke to you people last week that we couldn't hear you at home. I come out tonight because they couldn't hear any one of you people. I went upstairs this afternoon to see if I could see the mayor's assistant. She was busy. So I spoke to the secretary and she was going to give the message. And I wanted to know why something couldn't be done about this system. I've been told by the technician up back that the reason we don't hear anything is because you people don't talk into the microphone. And every time you speak as individuals, your heads are going back and forth like Woody the Woodpecker talking to each other instead of in the speaker. Now, we have three pages on the agenda tonight. Do you think it's right that people at home that are shut in can't understand what's going on when there's three pages on the agenda? Don't you think that we should be accorded enough courtesy that we can at least hear what you've got to say? Nothing's being done about this. This is my second trip in here. Now, the mayor's in the hall. I don't know who put the system in, but it seems to me that if he wants us to hear what he's got to say, or you've got to say, or maybe he doesn't want us to hear, I don't know. It's time to have this system fixed so the people at home can hear what's going on. This is a disgrace. It's disrespectful. I'm into my 87th year, and I've been paying taxes all my life here. I'm older than any one of you people. And I can't hear a thing because you don't have a system that's working. And I understand all these mics are all new. Got to put them in a disposal box outside. Buy some more new ones. See if you can't bring somebody in that can set up a system so we can hear at home. We deserve that much.
Point is well taken, Mr. Graney.
Thank you.
And I'm not a soft-spoken guy, and I know that people have trouble hearing me, and it's not for a lack of me trying. But the amp up here, if we turn it up to do what it ought to do, you've heard what happens. The unfortunate, it just gives a terrible humming noise. So they try to find the, you know, the best balance that they can. And it's, but it is difficult. We do need to have eye contact with one another. I appreciate the problem of when you do that.
When you're talking back and forth,
it's the unfortunate. The unfortunate part is the system. It isn't for a lack of our trying. It's a problem with the system, and I agree. And so maybe a few of us will visit the mayor and see what we can do about a capital expenditure for a new amplifier, because we do have new microphones.
With all the money we spend,
and we do want to be heard.
With all the money we spend in the town of Angry, we ought to at least have a system that we can hear the results of voting on.
But really, thank you for coming
Mr.
forward
Graney,
with that.
I appreciate it.
Also, while I'm here, this DPW garage up on the Hunt Road, I drove up there today. I think it's somewhere in the vicinity of 2 miles from there to the Titcomb's truck stop. Also, Waste Management and SCA coined money like no bank, hauling debris into that place. And now they want us to put a sewage system because they have a vessel in there that contains the water on rainy weather, you know? We done an I&I years ago to eliminate water from cellars going into the sewer drains. And now we're gonna turn around and put a sewer line in so that they can dump all the leachate from the dump into the sewer line. And they want to make a swap for the land. I think it's a poor swap. The truck stop we own it. There's water and sewer there. There's room enough to put a building on that site, take care of the compost out back, put a salt shed on the site, and we can put a building up there out a little closer to the road, and we can do something to add curb appeal to the building, clean up the edges of the roads and so forth, and make it desirable. I can't see why we should be going out bartering for land in a dump that these people have made all kinds of money on. And we're gonna barter
with them. Mr. Graney, just try to wrap it up, okay, please? It's been about 6 minutes.
You're cutting me down?
No, I'm
you
saying...
You haven't stopped anybody else tonight from speaking.
I'm asking you to wrap it up. It's been 6 minutes. I haven't had to stop anybody yet. I appreciate it.
Well, I'd appreciate a little consideration. I'm talking about the truck stop now. Other people have talked about the truck stop, and I'm talking about the truck stop.
I appreciate it.
That's the place that the DPW garage should go, and not by the dump. And I hope you clock everybody else that gets up here to speak, the same as you do me.
Thank you, Mr. Graney.
Last week I was in here.
Excuse me, Mr. Granny.
I believe I let everybody speak on and on and on, but...
Is there anybody else in the audience that would like to speak? I would like now to ask for...
One more.
Oh, come on.
My name is Kevin Murphy. I live at 131 Pleasant Valley Road. And first of all, I'd like to thank the council for going slow on the DPW. As you can see, it's a very sensitive issue. I know you guys have a hard job. I mean, we heard to surmise some of the businessmen. One businessman says that he doesn't think the industry should be in that area. He's going to build condos on his property. Then we have 1,000 yards away another businessman that says he's going to add on to his business. And so I don't think there's quite a plan there. As far as the leachate goes, though, is this already a done deal? Because Saturday morning, I'm driving up Middle Road, and I see a large trailer truck, looks like a gasoline tanker truck, that pulls into the Middle Road pumping station for sewage. There's one driver. There was no EPA person, as the mayor said, was going to monitor this. Nobody measuring how much sewage this guy was going to dump. But the truck driver gets out of the truck, pumps the sewer to the town public sewage treatment plant, pump station, runs his hose in there, and proceeds to dump 8,000 gallons of leachate from the dump, I stopped and asked him where it came from, into the town sewer system. Mm-hmm. Nobody was there to measure how much that was going in there. I want to know, are these people paying the fee? I mean, the average homeowner has to pay $6.85 for, what is it, 100 cubic feet? So this guy right there was dumping roughly, you know, $100 worth of leachate into the sewer, and there was nobody there to monitor him. So I want to know, is this already a done deal? I mean, do they have the right to dump into our sewer system already? It's already been precluded that it's going through. I see that there's surveillance stakes all over the area. I'm really confused, and I'm disappointed with what we got from our public works director and our mayor on this. Somebody here asked him, is there any additional cost in building this building? And they said no. But then in the Daily News I read that the plans call for a gas mitigation system so that the methane gas coming from the dump won't enter the building. The DPW director, when he was asked, says there's wetlands in between there. So that's going to stop the gas. Anybody that looks at a bottle of soda, you see the little bubbles rising? You know gas rises through water. It's not going to stop. That was the reason in 1985 they tore down the two houses that were on that site that they wanted to build on. So please take your time. I mean, people have offered other sites. I think you should take and do what other towns do and take Woodson's Farm, which we paid dearly for, and replicate the cow barns that were there. You could build a DPW in two buildings that look like cow barns behind the... Plus, you'd run the storage and water into there. People that played at the soccer fields and stuff, you could have public bathrooms there that people could use when they go to Woodson's Farm, and would finally be getting some investment on our return for the Woodman Farm $5 million clawed that we paid for that. There wouldn't be as much site. We own the area. There's tons of land there. You could do composting and stuff. You could make it, keep it still looking like a farm, but you wouldn't have to get into bed with waste management and accept all this leachate. That's a big issue for the town. I appreciate
the
opportunity to talk.
Thank you very much, Mr. Murphy.
Thank you.
If that's all the comment, I would like to open up for council response to public comment. Who would like to speak?
Just for the people that are concerned about the DPW, the Finance Committee meets next on March 27th, 2 weeks from tonight. And, you know, again, the Finance Committee would open it up to public discussion. So people, I mean, obviously, we heard what was said tonight, and the Finance Committee will be taking it up again in 2 weeks if anybody else wants to amplify their remarks or add to them. Thanks.
Go ahead. And just one thing, if we could find out about the trucks that we just heard about dumping
into
the
system. I'm going to ask, actually, Mr. Damaris, if he would stop, hop up and chat on it for a second. If anybody else wants to make prior to that. Mr. Damaris, I'm not sure if you heard Mr. Murphy's comments about the leachate being dumped.
I did.
I was wondering if you could address those, just specifically that issue.
Yep.
Just,
Waste Management came to us, well, a long time ago, but they wish to, instead of transporting where they currently transport, I believe it's in Maine, to find a place to dispose of it in town, a manhole or a location in town where they can safely dispose of it into our sewer system. We come to the Middle Road site. It's there's not any houses around. It's off the road. The road's wide at that point. We have two locations, the Middle Road and the Clark's Pond Road, because it's a bigger pump station. Each tanker truck holds 8,000 gallons. Whether the truck is full or not, we charge them for 8,000 gallons. And we're notified every time they're there, and we verify that they're there. They've already known what the procedure is. All they do is open a manhole inside of a pump station and discharge into there.
So they log in and tell you that they're coming?
Yep.
And if it's 1 gallon or 8,000 gallons, they get charged for the 8,000 gallons?
That's right.
So they're not sneaking in the cover of night or day?
No. And they have to dispose of it between 7 and 3, Monday through Friday. There are provisions where if they have to do it on the weekend because of a rainstorm and they have extra leachate, we have a staff person come in and open it up for them. And they are charged a full rate.
And could you tell us about the nature of the leachate? In other words, what do you know about it?
We have Waste Management's analysis that they send off to their independent lab for reporting to the state. And we've looked at that, and it's, you know, relatively benign leachate. But, you know, it's some metals. It's not clean water, but it's, you know, nicer than most of the sewage in town.
Councilor
LaVoy? Is that a manifested weight, a waste? So in other words, are there logs kept?
Yes.
So in other words, they have to report to DEP.
Correct.
What they're doing with it, moving it under pains and penalties of perjury.
Correct.
And they are a regulated business.
Yep. And they all that stuff they provide to us.
And if I recall from your presentation 2 weeks ago at Finance, I think you did speak about this. And I think we've been doing it historically for over 10 years at least, right?
Well, back in the 80s, we took all the leachate from them. They stopped doing it for a while, and now they've come back to us over the last couple of years to do this. We just started doing the transport into the pump station in January.
Okay.
And we do have the capacity at the sewage treatment plant to handle this extra?
We do. And Waste Management was reserved 60,000 gallons as part of a deal inked in the late 80s. So 60,000 gallons capacity, the average daily capacity at the plant is dedicated to Waste Management. 32,000 they used for the Merrimack Landing subdivision. They have 28,000 remaining. Their average daily flow over an annual basis for this leachate is 12,000 gallons a day.
But the capacity was there for 30,000?
We have the capacity of the plant is roughly this is 2.5 million gallons per day. Our current average flows are around 1.7 million gallons a day, so we have excess capacity. Of that excess capacity, 60,000 gallons was reserved for Waste Management as part of a deal a while ago. They used some of it for the Merrimack Landing development. They have some left, and they're using that capacity to dispose of this leachate. So of all the excess capacity at the wastewater treatment plant, 60,000 was reserved from waste, so they're not taking away from any future development in Amesbury. It's already been reserved for them.
And did you say 25 million gallons is the capacity?
2.5.
You know, lawyers, they exaggerate all the time. 2.5 million. And right now, waste pays for every gallon that they
correct
into our system.
Correct.
And they pay the same rate as anybody else in Amesbury?
Yep.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
And can I just ask one more question? And that was the
give back on the land?
We haven't gotten that agreement on the land. This is specifically an agreement.
Historic.
Yeah, historic agreement between Waste Management and the town. But if, in the future, it's going to be a different agreement.
This current arrangement has nothing to do with the land deal of the DPW.
And this goes back probably 30 years?
Or more, yeah.
Because I remember hearing that the original lychee was a little bit more stronger.
Correct.
The town did not accept it.
It caused problems with our sludge, yes.
So we denied him for a while till he got a little bit better sanitation for the...
Well, actually, the waste just ages over time, and it's the lychee becomes less strong over time, and to the point where in a few years, they will not have to dispose of it at all. But then our current, and that is all determined by DEP.
So we were last familiar about the Titcomb landfill site, a closure report on that. There is an existing closure report for that dump site, the old SCA, now Waste Management.
Yep.
It's on file at DEP if anybody wanted to go look at it.
Yep.
It's, you're not aware of any violations of that closure order?
Nope. I have the final permit issuance, or the most recent permit issuance. There's no violations.
It's a capped landfill?
It's a capped landfill.
DEP's happy with it?
Near as I can tell, yes. Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Damaris.
And can I ask one more question?
Sure.
We anticipate that we're going to have more information before the Finance Committee?
That's correct.
Meeting, correct?
That's correct. And what we asked for specifically were there's issues on contracts. And if we don't have it, we will continue it again. That's a prerequisite of our doing any vote.
Okay.
Okay, the night is moving right along here. I would like to go right into public hearings. We have a handful of public hearings, and I appreciate everybody's time and patience. Really do. I'd like to open the public hearing. 2012-020, amend the zoning map. Mayor Keyser, the sponsor.
Madam President? I have a report from the Ordinance Committee.
That's good. I'd love to have a report from the Ordinance Committee.
So the Ordinance Committee met on Tuesday, February 21, 2012, on Bill 2012-020. It's an amendment to the Amesbury zoning map. It deals with Clark Road, map 80, parcel 5 and 24, to go all to R20, and map 80, parcel 16, to go all to commercial. And Mr. Johnson moved to recommend the Municipal Council that the zoning map be changed as enumerated in Bill 2012-020 and the accompanying design diagram. Mr. Kimball seconded it. It was voted by the Ordinance Committee unanimous. Subsequent to that, I was in attendance at the Planning Board meeting last night. For those that may not be familiar, the way zoning changes are made in a city, which Amesbury has been since 1996. It's a vote of the Municipal Council. However, under statute, the Planning Board has 45 days to comment, and until those 45 days go by, with or without a comment, and the substance of the comment, yay or nay, doesn't bind the Municipal Council from, you know, ultimately acting as the Municipal Council decides in its best judgment. But those 45 days have not passed yet, and at last night's Planning Board meeting, this bill and the next bill, which ordinance hasn't moved out of ordinance yet, these two rezonings were continued by the Planning Board. So even though ordinance has reported on this one and it's now in the record, you know, so we've discharged our duty as the Ordinance Committee, the Municipal Council tonight legally cannot, in my opinion, cannot act on 020 or 021.
Okay. So, Councilor Neal?
When we get ready, I'd like to make a motion.
Okay, is there any other, go ahead. I think we're ready for a motion, Councilor Neal.
I'd like to make a motion to continue 2012-020 to our next Municipal Council meeting.
Second.
Second by Councilor Voy. Any discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you. On 2012-022, it's a appropriate 2012-021, amend the Amesbury zoning bylaw and Amesbury overlay zoning map, and...
Counselor Lavoy did a great job at summarizing both bills, so I would move at this time to continue 2012-021 to our next municipal council.
Do I have a second? Counselor Lavoy seconds, all in favor?
Can I speak to that for a minute? I'm not opposed to the motion, and it's something we need to do, but this will be before the planning board again 2 weeks from now, from last night, on the 26th, and I would encourage anyone who lives in the vicinity of the water treatment plant to check out the map, make sure your property is or is not affected. I brought up and requested, and I need to formalize it in writing to the mayor's office, that I would respectfully request that the mayor's office consult Koppelman and Page in terms of what grandfathering protections there will be for those landowners affected by the new regulations. There's not much we can do about the regulations. DEP mandates it. It's been something that's been in process probably for 15 years, and, you know, resistance is futile, but I think people should check it out. Anybody interested, please attend the planning board meeting 2 weeks from now.
I think, just to add to Counselor Lavoy's comments, I do believe there's maps on file, too, so you can sort of see how the new changes will affect. Basically, just using the eyeball test, it looks like the area that will be affected will be increased.
Significantly.
Pretty significantly, so if anybody wants to come from the public to look at the maps, they can do that.
Okay, do we have a motion?
We do.
Okay. So this was essentially continuing it to the next ordinance committee? Okay. So all in favor? Any opposed? That's unanimous. The next is 012022, appropriate $8 million for the new DPW facility. Mayor Keyser sponsor. This was continued at the last finance committee meeting, so the next time we're scheduled to discuss this is March 27th at 7 o'clock. So...
Make a motion to continue this to our next council meeting.
Second.
Counselor Gilday seconds, all in favor? Any opposed? It's unanimous. We have one more public hearing, and that is on 2012-024. The municipal council authorized the mayor to petition the Merrimack Valley Planning Commission to discontinue its interest in a road, county road parcel. Mayor Keyser sponsor. Counselor Lavoy, were you ready to speak on this?
Yes. Once again, the ordinance committee dealt with this on its meeting of Tuesday, February 21, 2012, and it was moved and voted, seconded and voted unanimously to recommend to the municipal council that the council authorize the mayor to petition Merrimack Valley Planning Commission to discontinue its interest in a county road parcel, which at present occupies the majority of the frontage of 15 Havel Road, and further continuing and ending with Plan Book 422, Plan 5. And again, that was a unanimous recommendation. I know that there's Attorney DeRocky, who represents this landowner, and made a fine presentation to the ordinance committee, and the council may want to hear from him during the public meeting.
Okay. Tonight.
Tonight.
Okay.
So we recommended approval.
Recommended approval, okay.
Could we give him...
You have to open the public.
Yeah. Oh, I thought that was still opening. Open. Open a public hearing. Would you like to speak on this issue, sir?
Mr. DeRocky?
Attorney DeRocky, please.
Chris DeRocky representing...
Excuse me.
Into the mic.
Chris DeRocky representing C. Stephen DeRocky. Just to be brief, my brother is attempting to sell this portion of land, and through a 1907 taking, that created a title defect where there is no frontage, or a significant amount of the frontage is gone from that. The same problem existed where the Andy Man parcel of land is. They went through the same process. That took, I think, I spoke with their attorney, it took 7 years to complete it. We're trying to do this a little bit quicker, so we're asking that the Municipal Council authorize the mayor to petition the Merrimack Valley Planning Commission to discontinue that road.
Chris, would you try to, I know it's difficult.
Just with the microphone.
We're not hearing it, and we're pretty sure the people at home aren't hearing it.
Sorry about that.
Yeah.
Mr. Graney, I'll do that again.
Yeah.
This is a title defect. My client is trying to sell a piece of property. It has come to, it's under agreement, but at the present time, the buyer's attorney is concerned that this taking from 1907 has taken the frontage, and therefore it's not a marketable piece of property. What we're seeking to do is to have the Merrimack Valley Planning Commission discontinue their interest in the property and have it become surplus property for the town of Amesbury, and then deal with it from there.
Thank you. Would we like to do a motion first and then have more discussion?
Or I don't know if there's anybody else that wants.
Is there anyone else in the audience that would like to speak on this issue? If not, I would entertain a motion. Council Lavoie.
Madam President, on 2012-024, the seeking authorization of the mayor to petition MVPC to discontinue its interest in a county road parcel at 15 Haver Road, I would move that in accordance with the ordinance committee recommendation that Municipal Council pass this bill as requested.
Second the.
Second by Councilor Neal. Any discussion?
Just quickly, as the attorney mentioned, this is the same process that was done with Andy Mann's. When Essex County government was abolished 15, 20 years ago, there are residual rights relative to county roads, and that's what 110 is. It's a county road. And what happens is over time, the Mass Highway realigns Route 110, and they don't need everything they took in 1907. So it's been like an orphan piece of property, and until thorough title examination is done, matched up with surveys, you know, it takes a really thorough examination to spot this. It has been spotted. The fix, you know, is very simple. You know, I happen to serve on Merrimack Valley Planning Commission. I've served on a Boxford parcel. It's an interesting process, but it is just a routine process. So I recommend approval.
I just comment that Mr. DeRocky makes a good point. We did this for the Andy Man's property, but a year ago, as I recall, maybe a year and a half ago. So it's in keeping with what we have done historically.
Consistent.
That too.
Is there any more discussion? No. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'd like to, we have a motion. I'd like to close the public hearing. And then I'd like to have a vote. All in favor of this, please raise your right hand. All opposed? None opposed? It's unanimous. Okay. So we're going to move right on to second readings. 2012-015, request the Municipal Council vote to declare as surplus various municipal vehicles. Mayor Keyser's sponsor. The summary is the surplus 2002 Dodge Ram van, 1995 Ford E350, and a 205 Chevy Impala.
Recommendation from the Finance Committee?
Yes. We do have a recommendation from the Finance Committee, and Councilor Ferguson moved to send 2012-15 to the Municipal Council with a recommendation for approval as submitted. Councilor McMillian seconded it, and it was a unanimous vote. As everybody recalls, these things were vehicles that really have no value, and the useful life is up. And I think there were no objections by any of us to seeing these vehicles go to pasture, I guess.
Does Anybody want to make a motion on this issue?
I make a motion that we pass 2012-015 to declare a surplus various municipal vehicles.
Is there a second?
Second.
Councilor Kelcor seconds. Do we have any discussion?
No.
Okay. You want to discuss or no? Okay. All in favor, please raise your right hand.
You really need a roll call on this.
A roll call. Oh. Okay, sorry.
Councilor Kimball?
Yes.
Councilor Lavoie?
Yes.
Councilor McClure?
Yes.
Councilor Neal?
Yes.
Councilor Gilday?
Yes.
Councilor Kelcor?
Yes.
President Ferguson?
Yes.
Unanimous.
Thank you. The next is 2012-016, appropriate $45,000 from free cash for weed abatement at Lake Attitash. Mayor Keyser's sponsor. The summary of this bill is this order will provide the funding for the Lake Attitash Sonar Herbicide Treatment Program. Working with the Lake Attitash Association, these funds will assist in the implementation of the Lake Attitash Weed Management Plan. We have a Finance Committee recommendation.
We do. It was Councilor McMillian moved to send 2012-16 to the Municipal Council with a recommendation for approval as submitted. Councilor Gilday seconded it, and it was voted unanimous. And the outstanding issues at the time, the good folks at the Lake Attitash Association have been studying this problem for a long time, and the money that we're going to give them is going to be tied to money that they've collected. They've collected, I believe, in excess of $50,000 already. And it is a multiple times will they have to treat the waters to try to get rid of these weeds, essentially. And without doing it, there's a high likelihood that these weeds will overtake the lake. And in fact, they'd have a dead lake, and values of the property all around that lake will plummet. And as you look at the rest of the taxpayers in Amesbury, frankly, what that will result in is a shifting of their tax burden to the rest of the town. As their values drop, we'll have to pick up the monies that they don't pay in taxes. So there's a significant reason, number one, why we should help them as all taxpayers. And additionally, the lake serves as a a secondary source of supply for our drinking water. That's another big reason why the entire town should share in it. I don't recall many other things other than they also follow our procedures with regard to going out to bid. So we will not be in a jam like we were years ago with some other things. They have already taken the precautions and done the bidding in an appropriate way. So there you have it, Madam President.
Will we take a motion first, or will we open it up for comment?
You can ask for discussion.
Okay. I think to start with, I have two forms for discussion on this issue, and I would like to call Bruce Witten up from to speak on this issue.
Hello, my name is Bruce Witten. I live at 12 Lakeshore Drive, and I've lived there for 35 years, and I've seen a tremendous deterioration in the quality of the water at the lake, the invasive weed species, and the dangerous blue-green algae that we've been having blooms of for quite a few years now. So as a citizen, I am so pleased that some of my neighbors took the initiative of starting the Lake Attitash Association and have put so much time and energy into this. They, as you mentioned, they've done the research, they've done fundraising, they've spent countless hours personally monitoring the water, and I believe now they have around $60,000 saved. Now, there are many people who have contributed to that, just ordinary Amesbury citizens. One person contributed $2,500. Many people have contributed $1,000. Many of my neighbors have contributed $500, $300. So I think it's a really unique time of participation. And I just think it would be great if the town joins in with this and brings it to completion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Philip Ostrander.
Good evening. Philip Ostrander, 21 Lakeshore Drive. Bruce kind of said it all. I've been at the lake 12 years. The cyanobacteria in the algae in the past 5 years has accelerated. As it's been put to me, the lake has reached its saturation point. And, you know, with the community rallying behind this and the fundraising, which I've been involved in, and there's a lot of people that are concerned, I think it's great that the town has stepped up or is looking at this as a serious matter for the reasons you brought up. The tax base will go down if the lake dies, and it's in jeopardy of doing that. Secondly, it's a resource that the town has, and we want to keep it. You know, it's a beautiful lake. It can be saved, and it just takes money and efforts. We have the efforts here, and with the town support, I think we can get there. The lake can be saved. So really, I'm here to support what you're all doing.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? I will now entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion that we accept 2012-016, appropriate $45,000 from free cash for weed abatement at Lake Etitash.
I will second the motion.
Councilor Neal seconds. Any discussion?
I'd just like to make a comment that I think it's, as an individual who grew up on the water, it's very important that we protect this and do what we can to save. I didn't grow up on Lake Etitash, I did grow up on the Merrimack River, and I've seen a significant change over the past several years in the quality of the water over there. And I think it's really, really important that we do what we can to mitigate any of the weed damage that's occurred over there and to just really protect this great resource that we have in this town. It's really unique, and we're very fortunate to have it. So I fully support it.
Any other discussion?
Okay. I just mentioned that Councilor McMillian can't be with us tonight, but Joe McMillian has worked tirelessly on this issue, and he's worked well with the Lake Etitash Association. He does live right on the lake, so he's firsthand knowledge about what the problem is, and he's worked very hard to bring this forward, to convince the mayor to authorize it out of free cash, and I think we're hearing that the council is fully in support of it.
I would like to thank the members of the Lake Etitash group. I mean, the amount of time you all have spent and put in is just amazing. And I again say that another resource this community has is the people that are willing to put all the time towards something that they feel so strongly about. And I really personally appreciate the lake and appreciate the time and energy you all have put into it. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
If there's no further comment, I'm ready to take a vote. All in favor?
Roll call.
Roll call. Sorry, thanks, Bonnie.
Councilor Kimball?
Yes.
Councilor Lavoie?
Yes.
Councilor McClure?
Yes.
Councilor Neal?
Yes.
Councilor Gilday?
Yes.
Councilor Kelcourse?
Yes.
And President Ferguson?
Yes.
7 yes, unanimous.
Good job.
Thank you for holding in there, because we've had a long day, 4 pages of agenda, so we still have more.
No, fun. Stick around.
Stick around.
Hey,
it's lots of FUN. Moving right on, 2012-017, accept a $28,750 grant from Federal Emergency Management Agency and the Department of Homeland Security. Mayor Keyser's sponsor. The summary is the Amesbury Fire Department has been awarded a grant totaling $28,750. This total represents the federal share to be $27,313 and the city share to be $1,437. This grant will be used to purchase and install a vehicle exhaust removal system for the Elm Street Fire Station. This equipment is designed to remove exhaust associated with starting any vehicle inside the fire station. Councilor Neal, would you like to give us a Finance Committee recommendation?
Surely. Councilor Ferguson moved to send 2012-017 back to the Municipal Council with a recommendation for approval as submitted. Council Gilday seconded it, and it was voted unanimously. And I think it's fabulous that they found the money, because we have to have a system like this to take all that bad stuff when you start up a vehicle out of the building, so particularly where they're going to be living quarters. And the city share, by the way, everybody, is $1,437. I believe the chief told us he could find it in his budget to come up with a city share. He wouldn't be pestering us for $1,437 more. So I think that was the nature of the grant and all the reasons why.
I'd like to open this up to discussion. I know that the chief has been sitting over in the corner dying to get up and talk on this issue, so because he didn't do anything else all day. But primarily, we did have a big discussion about it at Finance, but briefly, if you could just, you know, say hello and...
For the viewers at home.
For the viewers, they can see your face, and just be sure to use your microphone.
And 3-minute rule, please.
Good evening. For the record, John Brickett, Fire Chief. I'll do a quick synopsis. This grant was put in based on a need. The federal government looks very strongly at this type of a safety system for firefighter safety. We were very fortunate to make the third round on this, which we've never done before. And I will confirm that the city's share will come out of the operating budget this year.
Thank you. Thank you very much. How's the Elm Street opened on last Wednesday?
Elm Street Station opened at 8:00 on Wednesday. It's been operational with really no flaws at this point. We're reviewing our operational plan that we wrote about a month and a half ago. And generally, we look at that within a 1 to 2 week period to make sure that everything's fine. But as it looks now, it's going very well.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else that would like to comment? If not, I'd like to entertain a motion.
I'd like to entertain a motion that 2012-017 accept a $28,750 grant from Federal Emergency Management Agency and the Department of Homeland Security.
We have a second?
Second.
Councilor Lavoie got it in first. He seconds the. Any discussion?
Just real quick to acknowledge again the chief and fire department for the hard work that they do applying for these grants. It's not an easy task. It's competitive. I think the town really does appreciate you guys stepping up and doing that, taking that task on. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Roll call.
Sorry, I'm a little
Councilor
tired.
Kimball?
Yes.
Councilor Lavoie?
Yes.
Councilor McClure?
Yes.
Councilor Neal?
Yes.
Councilor Gilday?
Yes.
Councilor Kelcourse?
Yes.
And President Ferguson?
Yes.
Unanimous, 7 yes.
Posse's moved on, and we've been no less successful with the grant monies.
Is there any discussion on this issue from the audience? Or would Chief, would you like to speak on it? I know you spoke at it in Finance, but it's such a nice tie on. We want to see that again.
Again, for the record, John Brickett, Fire Chief. This grant is, as Councilor Neal said, it's a grant that's offered to municipalities in the state that actually devote to the school system for fire education. I have to give all the credit for this grant and this program to the Ozzie Morrill, who was actually newly retired this past year, and his brother Jerry Morrill actually took the program over with the firefighter Jeremy Bean. And they actually put together the grant application and was awarded this grant. And I need to preface one thing, that we really have the first curriculum-based education program with interns from the high school, which is really, we actually set the tone for the state and other communities in the Commonwealth are now following suit with this. We're very successful with three full-time firefighters that are educated through the academy that actually started through the internship program at the high school. So, very great program.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any further discussion from the audience? Okay, I'd like to entertain.
I'd like to make a motion, 2012-018, accept a $5,265 grant from the Mass Department of Fire Services.
Do I have a second? Councilor Neal seconds. Any discussion? Could we have a roll call? How's that? It only took like five times and I got it.
Yes.
Councilor
Boyd?
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Councilor Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. The next is 2012-019. Thanks, Chief, for being here for us. 2012-019, appropriate $200,000 from free cash for the repair and maintenance of streets and sidewalks, Mazur Keyser sponsor. The summary of this order will provide the funding for repairs and maintenance of streets and sidewalk per the DPW infrastructure and pavement plan. Council Neal, do you have a recommendation from the Finance Committee?
We do. Councilor McMillian moved to send 2012-019 back to the Municipal Council with a recommendation for approval as submitted. Councilor Kelcor seconded it, and it was approved unanimously. And just a brief, I'll give a brief summary, and you can call Rob up to give a more thorough summary. But this is going to be in addition to the monies that the department usually receives from the state to repave roads. We're asking to have this money come out of free cash, and there was quite a list of streets and sidewalks, as I recall, that was tied to this money. And it's long overdue. I don't want to speak long about it, but we all know that the condition of the roads and sidewalks are not the best, and at least this can be a start in addition to the monies the state gives us. Thanks.
Rob, would you love to come up and chat with us about this?
Good evening, Rob Damaris, Director of Public Works. This is a request to appropriate $200,000 to pave 17 streets in town. It's a leveling course, a sort of a thin layer of asphalt over these roads. All the roads that were selected in this particular appropriation are private, but maintained by the town. We have no other source of funding for these types of roads. We can't use state funds or Chapter 90 funds or grant funds. So that's how these roads were selected.
Rob, you have a list of the streets on the webpage?
Yep. Yes.
And you have a schedule?
Yes.
When they're going to be done?
There's no dates assigned to them other than the year.
Okay. But you will notify the residents on that street when you're going to be going out and doing the work?
Yes, we do.
Thank you.
Can you just clarify that? Yeah, there are a lot of ways to repave, but this is not grind down to the subgrade and rebuild, which would be prohibitively expensive. We could probably do, what, a couple of miles a year if we did that?
Not even. I'm sorry, I don't have the total right in front of me here. But it's about eight times more expensive to do the sort of grind the road up and then relay it. This is basically an inch and a half of pavement. We did this treatment on Route 150 into town, Elm Street, Pleasant Valley Road, Congress Street, Southampton Road, and Market Street recently. It creates a fresh road surface that gives us 5 to 10 years of wear on the road before we have to start working on it again. At that point, if we catch it early enough, if we give it an additional treatment, it will last even longer. On lightly traveled roads, which most of these proposals are, it lasts even longer. The reason for doing this other than just cost, is most of these roads need substantial infrastructure work in addition to paving. We don't currently have the resources available to do that. So for instance, Lake Attitash Road has a very old water main that's undersized and breaks frequently. So it would be inadvisable to invest heavily into that road knowing that we're going to be that back there repairing it. It's just a thin layer of pavement over what's there. Before we pave it, we level the road out a bit, any potholes and so forth, so they don't reflect through. But it just kind of gives us a smooth wearing surface for the next few years.
Thank you.
And just to follow up on that, there are some in the community that view it as like a fool's errand of spending, wasting money because it's only going to last a year or two. Your projections are 5 to 10 years. Mm-hmm. It's a wearing surface, so we're replacing the wearing surface. On side roads, you'll last even longer because there's little, local traffic.
I will comment, if there is a existing structural problem with the road, a drainage problem and so forth, where the road continually fails there, it will continue to fail there again until that problem is solved. Woodman Road is a perfect example of that. We can pave that every day and it will still fail. Just the drainage and the soils on that road are in such condition. However, we have to do something with these roads. They're in atrocious condition. These are the worst roads in town. And I'm sure many residents can argue with me over whether they are the worst roads in town, but as near as we could tell, these are the ones that fit within the budget and all the criteria we selected, so. Thank
you. Is there any further discussion or questions for Mr. DeMaris?
While you're there, can you just remind the public that on the town's webpage, I mean, if they have a complaint about a pothole or something, they can request a work order?
Yep.
And
yes,
you monitor it?
There is a... I can't describe how to get there, but on the website, there's a contact to send a notice to staff. Hey, we need something here, and we address it pretty regularly. And if you have a pothole in front of your house, do not wait. We're not coming there. We're generally not coming there to fix it. We don't know about it. You have to call, and we try to work for a 48-hour response time on potholes, and we're pretty successful at that. But again, if we don't know about it, we can't fix it.
Thank you.
Any other discussion?
Just one question. What do we have in free cash?
And that's Mike Bass, could you just tell us how much we have in free cash?
Over a million.
Well, a few minutes ago, be a little bit less than that.
$1,159,000. We just spent 45.
So. Okay. All right. Thank
and
you.
Now another two.
Right.
$200,000. Thank you. Okay, I would like to take a motion. I'd like to entertain a motion.
2012-019, appropriate $200,000 from free cash for the repair and maintenance of streets and sidewalks.
I have a second. Councilor Neal seconds. Any discussion? Okay.
You just want to ask
if there's any more discussion from the audience? Oh, sure, come on up. I'm sorry.
Just a question. I wanted to clarify. It's probably clerical thing and oversight. Phil Ostrander, 21 Lakeshore Drive. I'm on Lakeshore Drive. First, second, third, and fourth street coming down to Lakeshore Drive are all on the map as paved. Lakeshore is not. Just want to make sure it's included. That's all.
It's probably in such great shape that.
There you go.
That's how we feel about that.
Take a ride down. You'll see.
I talked to Mr. DeMaris too because mine's not on there either. And I was really disappointed about that, but.
It's still dirt, right?
Well, I mean, if you've ridden up there, it would make sense. I mean, that all four streets tie, actually five streets tie into Lakeshore Drive.
So you would cast your vote for what street again?
Lakeshore Drive.
Thank you.
Okay, well, we'll chat with Mr. DeMaris about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably just an oversight because, you know, the streets would.
How could they possibly miss your street, right?
Well, no, yeah.
It is right attached. I know that.
Yeah, if you've driven down there, they all dump into Lakeshore. So I'm sure it's just an oversight, but I wanted to make sure it was.
Okay. Caught. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other discussion? Okay, can I have a roll call, Bonnie, please?
Abstain.
Abstain. Yes. Councilor Lavoie?
Yes.
Councilor McClure?
Yes.
Councilor Neal?
Yes.
Councilor Gilday?
Yes.
Councilor Kelkhorst?
Yes.
Councilor Ferguson?
Yes.
Six yes, one abstain.
Thank you guys for coming. We really appreciate it. The final second reading is 2012-023. Amend Addendum N of the 8th Session Municipal Council Rules. Councilor Lavoie and President Ferguson sponsor. I'm going to have Vice President Gilday read it because I'm a sponsor.
Okay. Summary, the purpose of this bill is to amend Addendum N of the Ainsbury Municipal Council's 8th Session Rules and Procedures in order to clarify how appropriate questions raised during public comment will be memorialized and responded to. Speakers during public comment who raise a specific question which they seek to be answered by the Municipal Council must write out their questions clearly so that the Council does request the Town Clerk office to do so. The Town Clerk will be able to forward the question to the appropriate department or office within the administration for a written response so that the Council will be in a position to respond to the questions during a later monthly Council meeting.
Councilor Lavoie or McClure or Neil were on the Rules Committee, and I was wondering if you could give us a report on what you discussed at your Rules meeting.
With the consent of my colleagues on the Rules Committee, Councilor Neil, Councilor McClure, I'll report for us, if that's okay. Basically, the Rules Committee met this evening and voted unanimously to recommend approval as submitted. And as one of the co-sponsors, can I add one other thing?
Yes, you may.
So basically, all this rule does is codifies in written form what we talked about the last meeting and perhaps at a workshop. And if you'll indulge me, I'll just read quickly what the new paragraph on Addendum N. So the public speaker form that everybody fills out every meeting when they want to address us, we'll just have one additional paragraph that summarizes pretty much what the summary said. It says, it is important to know that this is a comment form. Specific questions should be first directed to the appropriate department head relating to your question and then to the mayor. If you continue to have a specific question for the municipal council, please present your question clearly, and if so requested by the council, the clerk's office will attempt to get a response for you as soon as possible so that the council can respond to you during a later monthly council meeting. And then there's plenty of room on the form to fill out your question. If you're inspired that night, you come up with a question after listening to others, there's place on the form now, and that way, if you turn your speaker form in and you come to the podium and say, I've left a written question, here's the substance of it, I'd like the council to address it, then council will have the opportunity to do it in an orderly fashion.
Do we have any discussion from the audience?
Jane Snow, 44 Fern Avenue. I realize it's the appropriate thing to go to a specific department, but I think what a lot of people have is frustration that questions aren't answered. Is there any way that you can help citizens by supporting and saying when they put in a request to a department or to the mayor that they get a response within X amount of time, and then people don't get so frustrated that they come here because they're looking for an answer? I know with the question that I just posed to you with regards to this, you know, it's very frustrating that we've talked about this until we're blue. We all know it's illegal to dump in the leaf dump, and you get assurances, no, this hasn't been discussed in front of the council, nothing's going forward, but it happens, and they collected money. So I think if people know that they can get a written response in a timely fashion from those people and that it's honored, then it would be helpful. And I don't know how you could do that, but that would be, from my frustration,
we have actually, I'm going to just barrel right into this. We have discussed this from the first meeting we had in January, that we will take down any questions that we have that we are not able to answer. And I have requested the department's heads be here to speak on an issue when they can. And Rob Damaris did speak on several issues. But there's some issues that I don't have the specific question. We will have it by the next meeting. Okay, and that's our deal. We're working really hard to do that. I did not answer any questions because all the questions that we had were on the DPW last week, and therefore we will discuss that at the Finance Committee meeting. But I understand your frustration, but we are really working on it.
And sometimes we get a rhetorical question that's very difficult, to answer. Sometimes there's correct facts, and sometimes there's incorrect facts, and sometimes it's hard to get a definitive answer on those, but when it comes down to black and white questions and answers, I think we can provide them as we have in the past.
Is there any more discussion?
Yep. I'm ready to vote on this, but it might be a good time for you to have the discussion that we had prior to the meeting with regards to public comment and public hearing, and maybe to just clarify for the public how we are going to do that going forward to make sure that everyone is clear in case there are anyone.
Thank you.
Anyone here?
That's great, Councillor McClure. So we Mr. Gonthier brought it to our attention that we have been having all of our public hearings at the Finance or the Ordinance Committee meetings. And we have all read through the 8th Council Municipal Rules, and we have agreed with Mr. Gonthier that in the past we changed, but we never actually changed our rules. So I'm trying to talk to the microphone, Mr. Graney. I am, really. It's just, so what we're going to do is we are from now on, and the reason we're having discussion as if it's a public hearing now is because we are from now on going forward having all of our public hearings at a municipal council level. Now, we will allow public discussion at the finance and ordinance, but we want to be really clear that the final public hearings will be at the second reading at the municipal council. So there was some confusion, and we're trying to clarify those. So we also discussed it and decided that we weren't going to change our rules to mirror that. So we're going to stay with what it is published, and so that will be a slight change. But everybody will still have an opportunity to discuss it at the meetings, at the finance and ordinance. Thank you, Councilor McClure, for reminding me about that. I don't even know if we have a motion on the table. We don't, do we?
I didn't jump in yet. I'd like to make a motion of 2012-023, amend Amendment N of the 8th Sessions Municipal Council Rules.
It's not even that.
I'm on mute.
Might still be the
something kicked in. That's my motion.
Okay. Do I have a second? Councilor Kimball would love to second that. All in favor? All opposed? That's unanimous, Bonnie. I've had a request to have a 2-minute recess, if that's okay with you guys. We're just going to have a quick 2-minute recess, and then we'll be back, okay?
For the final act.
I'm going to call Charlie Cohen.
Readings 2012-031, in order to amend the Amesbury zoning bylaw in order to clarify the use of accessory solar photovoltaic systems as an accessory use. Councilor LaVoy, sponsor. Summary, the purpose of this bill is to amend the Amesbury zoning bylaw in order to clarify the use of solar photovoltaic systems as an accessory use and to regulate how solar photovoltaic systems shall be allowed and utilized in the residential district. Do I have a motion?
Madam President, I would move that this bill be referred to... All right.
You want the head ones,
It's in the amplifier.
I would move that we send this bill to the Ordinance Committee, to the Planning Board, and to the Energy Task Force for a recommendation.
Do I have a second for that? Council McClure seconds.
And to, I'm sorry, and to schedule a public hearing at the municipal council meeting.
Okay, do...
Can we have a vote, please? All in favor? All opposed? That's a positive, you're unanimous. 2012-032, requesting the municipal council vote to amend the provisions of the Amesbury zoning bylaws to allow the installation of solar energy structures and facilities in the city of Amesbury. Councilors Scorzoni, Lavoie, Kimball, sponsor. The summary of this is the purpose of this ordinance is to establish a solar photovoltaic overlay district and to allow the installation of solar energy facilities and structures in the city of Amesbury in order to become designated a green community by the state under Mass General Law Chapter 169 of the Acts of 2008. The city must establish as of right sitings bylaw for renewable energy development. The proposed amendments to the provision of the Amesbury zoning bylaw establish responsible standards for the placement, design, construction, operation, monitoring, modification, and removal of such installations. These standards also address public safety, minimize impacts on scenic, natural, and historical resources, and to provide adequate financial assurance for the eventual decommissioning of such installation. I'd like to entertain a motion.
I move that we recommend 2012-32 be sent to ordinance, and I believe it would be appropriate to also send it to Planning Board and the Energy Task Force for consideration as well.
That's great. Could I have a second?
And to schedule a public hearing, second.
And to schedule a public hearing at the Municipal Council. Could I have a second?
Second.
Councilor, what's your name? Kimball. Councilor Kimball seconds. All in favor? All opposed? That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
One abstained.
The next is 2012-033 to accept an $80,000 donation from the Amesbury Public Library Charitable Trust. Mayor Keyser sponsor. The summary of this bill is the Amesbury Public Library Charitable Trust has made this donation to fund improvements to the special collections in Amesbury rooms for the attached award letter. I'd like to entertain a motion. Councillor Kimball.
I move to refer 2012-033 to the Finance Committee and schedule a public hearing at our next Municipal Council meeting.
Thank you. And I have a second? Councillor Neal seconds. All in favor? Any opposed? That's unanimous. 2012-034, in order to request that the Municipal Council accept Mass General Laws, Chapter 59, Section 5, Clause 56, a local options personal exemption for Massachusetts National Guardsmen and Reservists. Councillor Gilday and Lavoie sponsor. A summary of this bill is upon the acceptance of this section by a city or town, the Board of Assessors may grant real and personal property tax abatement up to 100% of the total tax assessed to members of the Massachusetts National Guard and to reservists on active duty in foreign countries for the fiscal year they perform such service, subject to eligibility criterion to be established by the Board of Assessors. I'd like to entertain a motion. Would you like to do a motion?
Sure. I'd like to entertain a motion for 2012-034 in order to request that the Municipal Council accept Mass General Law Chapter 59, Section 5, Clause 56, a local option personal exemption for Massachusetts National Guardsmen and Reservists.
Do I have a second?
Second that.
Councilor Kelcor seconds. Is there any discussion?
What was the motion? To send it to Finance?
Yes. Okay.
And schedule a public hearing.
And schedule a public hearing. Should it go?
Yeah, I think
Board
that's...
Board of Assessors. Okay, can we amend? Would you like to amend
friendly
your...
Friendly amendment.
Friendly amendment.
Yes.
So why don't you say those words? I'd like to send it to the Finance Committee for a recommendation and to schedule a public hearing as well as to send to the Board of Assessors for a recommendation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, is that all right with you guys?
Yes.
Okay. All in favor? Any opposed? That's unanimous. On 2012-035, a resolution that the Amesbury Municipal Council establish a committee to be called Committee on Public Buildings and Infrastructure. Council LaVoie sponsor. The summary of this bill is in order to provide appropriate oversight for the real property and infrastructure assets owned by the municipality, as well as to provide an appropriate level of technical review of proposals to acquire, construct, refurbish, or surplus such public buildings and infrastructure. I'd like to entertain a motion. Councilor Kelkhorst?
I move that we send 2012-35 to the Rules and Procedure, Ordinance, and also I think it would be appropriate to...
Can I point of information?
Sure.
So as a resolution, this can be acted on tonight as a first reading. It doesn't need to go anywhere. Right. Of course, if the council thinks that it could be guided by ordinance, but I think we all know the issues.
I agree.
Okay, so
I would amend that motion then.
Withdraw and restate it.
I'll withdraw. Thank you, Councilor LaVoie. Withdraw, restate that we accept 2012-35, a resolution that the Amesbury Municipal Council establish a committee to be called the Committee on Public Buildings and Infrastructure. Councilor LaVoie sponsor. That we accept that.
Do we need to read the whole thing?
Only if you want to. I move we waive the reading.
Okay, I second that, and all in favor of waiving the reading? It's good. So all in favor of accepting the resolution sponsored by Councilor LaVoie on the Committee for Public Buildings and Infrastructure, please.
Discussion.
What?
You need a second for that.
That was just to accept, not reading it. Now I'm going to ask for.
Put my name down. Motion.
Yeah. Councilor Neal seconds.
Okay. Thank you.
Second and a half.
So we have a motion and we have a second. All in favor? That's unanimous. All opposed? Nobody. There we go. And finally, what we've been waiting for all night is.
Well, can I inquire?
Yes, you may.
Madam President, do you have any appointments you'd like to make to that committee?
Do you want me to do it tonight?
I'd prefer. I'd like.
Okay. Let's get it over with.
I think the council would like this committee to get underway right away.
Okay. This committee, tentatively, we are going. The committee, the four people on the committee will be Councilors McClure, Councilors LaVoie, Councilor Neal, and Councilor Gilday. All in favor? Okay.
All right. I move we approve your appointments.
Okay. Any second?
Second.
All in favor? And now,
without further ado,
motion to adjourn. Second.
Do we have two late files?
No. Oh. We already did those. I added them.
The four
appointments, and I added them in.
Yeah, I get the. I forgot I had the new.
So
sheet.
A motion to adjourn. A second of that for Councilor Neal, and all in favor?